literally like the hardest thing I've ever had to do.
Good evening. Thank you for coming. Thank you for joining us for Europe Week 2019. This is the fourth year that we're putting on Europe Week. Thank you to the EU delegation and to the US for generously funding Europe Week, which is why we also send a sign-up sheet around and surveys. These are things that are required by our grants, so we are grateful to you for helping us to comply with the grant agreements. Thank you for signing up. Europe Week this year, we are thrilled tonight to have this fantastic keynote on Brexit. But please come back every night this week. Tomorrow night we will be having a happy hour over at the Ackland Art Museum to talk about Europe through art, and Professor Susan Harbage Page will be showing a video about her work with textiles in Italy. Wednesday evening we'll be in 1005 showing three short films about LGBTQ rights and issues in Europe, and three faculty members will be discussing. Thursday evening we have our EU Prize for Literature winner, Portuguese author David Machado coming, who will be reading at the public library. Everything starts at 5:30 this week. And then Friday night, we'll meet out here at the atrium for our closing reception. And our EU essay winners will be recognized, the photo contest winners, and we will have music by our own students from the music department, as well as the Onyx Club toys, who have French influence in their work, and they have quite a following, so apparently this is a very exciting thing to be able to see them here on campus. So, thanks for coming, and please continue to come this week. It is my pleasure to introduce to you this evening Elizabeth Hoge and Gary Marks. Professor Hoge is the W.R. Keenan Distinguished Professor of Political Science here at UNC, and she's also a recurring Robert Schuman Fellow at the EUI in Florence. She is currently an interim chair of the Euro Major and the Transatlantic Master's Program. Gary Marks is Burton Craig Professor of Political Science at UNC. He is also a Robert Schuman Fellow at the European University Institute in Florence. And in 2010, he was awarded a Humboldt Forschungspreis, the Humboldt Research Prize for his contributions to political science. Professor Marks co-founded the University of North Carolina Center for European Studies and the EU Excellence Center of Excellence in 1994 and 1998, respectively, and served as the director until 2006. Professors Hoge and Marks have held numerous visiting professorships and received many fellowships. They held the chair in multilingual governance at the VU Amsterdam, FU, from 2004 to 2016. In 2017, they received the Daniel Elazar Distinguished Federalism Scholar Award of the APSA, American Political Science Association. From 2010 to 2015, they co-led an Advanced European Research Council-funded project on the causes and consequences of multilingual governance. It is summarized in 5 books. 3 have been published, and the 4th, A Theory of International Organization, is in press. Clearly, very impressive, and will tell us all we need to know to prepare ourselves for the actual Brexit, whatever that may entail. Thank you very much for being here this evening, for doing this. Without further ado,
Katie mentioned it's the fourth year of the of Europe Week, and it's just the third year of Brexit. And we're happy. We're really happy to tell you everything you like that can be known about Brexit. This will be an overnight presentation. Well, we're going to give it our best shot in the time that we have available.
Please turn your phones off, because you might upend us. You might
Right, so we're going to start.
Oh.
There we go. Now this is the what, and it's a very simple representation, and it gives you a couple of pointers off the bat. And I think perhaps the most important one of these is that when you consider the turnout of just over 72%, and the lead majority, which was Bear, 51.9, what we have by and multiplying those together, is that 37.5% of those who could have voted, voted to leave. And that for me is already an astonishing fact, because what essentially was intended with that leave vote was to reverse 45 years of British history, and perhaps the most complicated advent of British history, that's the immensely complicated interaction and connection between the United Kingdom and the European Union. The other thing that jumps out to you from this picture is that Brexit is fundamentally an English proposition. Of the 10 regions that are in England, all but one, London, voted for Leave. And the three that didn't, London, the most cosmopolitan part of the United Kingdom, the most export-oriented, the most diverse, the youngest, Scotland, which has always been distinct from the European Union, in which multi-level governance, the idea of being both a member of the EU and a part of the United Kingdom, is kind of a fundamental part of Scotland's identity. And then Northern Ireland, where many Catholics, almost all Catholics, and many Protestants were very concerned about the implications of Leave for movement across the border and the fundamental character of that freedom across the border, which is part of the peace that has been produced since the Good Friday agreement. Let's move on. That's the base of the result. Let's go on to why.
So what motivated the debate, the conflict, what has motivated it from before the vote, read it today, and it looks like even tomorrow and the days after. And here is a very simple picture. The question asked the people in surveys right before the referendum, so I take you back here to April, May 2016. What matters most to you when deciding on how to vote in the EU referendum? And it shouts at you. The people who intended to vote leave the European Union, it was immigration, first and foremost. And secondarily, you might be able to see it in the back even, the words country, sovereignty, control. For people who were intending to remain, it was the economy. And secondarily, and connected with that, rights. Right, the right to travel, to trade, to live, to work abroad, to go to holidays there. Right? The whole big bunch of it. These are clouds, so-called clouds. It's a technique of analyzing frequency of word usage in texts. And so the bigger the font, the more frequent that people use these terms. So it's an interesting way to explore.
Oh.
It's an interesting way to carry on. And this one. To extract from texts what people intend to say. Remember, you saw when you were still seeing it, there was immigration on the left and economy on the right. And this is so interesting. Essentially, it was indicative of how the debate was being conducted. People were not talking and arguing about the same issues. They were talking past each other. They care very deeply about different issues. And through over the past 3 years, very little of that has changed. I think there's a little bit of a shift, and we will maybe talk about that in Q&A if you're interested. But that is a fundamental characteristic of the Brexit debate right up to the referendum itself.
All right, the next slide, if you imagine this, the next slide shows the effect of age. Now, age is often important when you're looking at political attitudes, but for Brexit, age was the number one polarizing factor. And let me just read you two statistics. One, those that were 18 to 24, 73% of that age group was Remain. So almost three quarters of young people voted Remain. Then let's take the 25 and older. 27% leave for the young people. And that's a kind of a startling statistic. And you have to think of what's going on with the young people. And for young people, you know, they're traveling across Europe. There is the Erasmus program, which allows them to study in different universities outside of their own country. So many people in the young people in the UK thought it a natural event to go and study abroad in Europe. Now that's something that's pretty well established in the United States, study abroad, and many of our students do exactly that. That was a relatively new phenomenon in Europe. And then there's the desire of freedom of Europe, freedom of movement. And so, you know, one of the things that affected the result is that the turnout among those 65 and older was 90%. And for the younger people, 64%. So if you wanted the kind of the quickest way of getting to the result, it would be that difference in turnout, which exists in every election. But given the great disparity in their preferences, that was really important.
Age is a huge factor in understanding who votes, who voted for what. The second big one, or maybe even bigger, is education. If I'm asking you the question, not you, if I'm asking people in Britain the question, do you feel somewhat European or European? Then the single most important predictor of that is your education, the number of years you spent in school in some fashion. The association is enormous. And of course, living in this country and thinking of the debates that we are going through, the fundamental political choices that our country faces, the two sides of a cleavage, we can recognize this because we know that education too, for us, is more than just the number of years, it's more than just what you've done part of your life, it actually shapes your worldview. It does it, I think, in two ways, or we think in two ways. One is in an economic way. The more educated you are, the greater the set of skills and the more diverse your set of skills to cope with an increasingly fluid, open, competitive, unpredictable world out there, including a world that is increasingly global. But the other thing is, I think, something more cultural. And it is that education provides you with a set of skills and develops and hones attitudes that make you better equipped to deal with diversity. People living very different, unexpectedly different lives from your life. It's kind of, you could say it's a more abstract, a more portable key or cue for empathy with people who are not like you.
The next slide is a picture of a bus. Why is that important? The bus.
Yeah.
I was in England before the referendum, and on the buses right across London, I mean, everywhere you looked, it said, we send the EU £350 million a week. Let's fund our NHS, our National Health Service, instead. Vote Leave. And at the bottom of the bus, it says, let's take back control. I mean, who doesn't want to take back control? And who wouldn't rather devote the £350 million a week that the UK is sending to the European Union and put it into something that people really value, the National Health Service? The slight problem with that is that it is a lie. It is simply not true. Except what? The £350 million is the total amount that the UK does send. There's a rebate, a Thatcher-negotiated rebate of £100 million a week. Another £100 million a week goes into a variety of programs that go directly to UK citizens. And then on the top of that are the set of agencies, the health agency, which has just moved from London to Amsterdam. So what is the balance? Well, you have to also take into account the $39 billion that the UK will have to pay to the European Union to settle past a commitment.
Divorces don't come cheap, particularly not after so many years of betrothal and marriage.
Very true. And so, I mean, it says something about a referendum. It says something about falsehoods in advertising. And it says something about, I suppose you could say, the gullibility of individuals who are not deeply informed. But this bus had such an effect. You see it everywhere, on every corner, on every street. When you went out.
It's one of the arguments that is repeated time and again by those people who say, look, the first referendum, that was not fair game. We know much more now. We know much more accurately the pros and cons. People know much more accurately. You should give them a second chance, a second referendum. We'll probably get back to that. The next picture is also yours. Can you describe it?
I can. It is the most famous headline in the UK since Brexit. And it says, it's three words, enemies of the people. And there are three photographs there of three high court judges, enemies of the people, who determined, after the invocation of Article that were in order for the government to invoke Article 50, they would have to go to the House of Commons and get the House of Commons vote in order to start the process.
Boy, have they regretted that since. Yeah.
And so, I mean, the whole idea of Brexit was to give sovereignty to the UK Parliament. But here were the judges who said, well, you've got to go to the House of Commons first. Enemies of the people, I mean, that's a phrase that was coined by Robespierre and used by Lenin, both of whom wanted to eliminate their opponents. So it has a deep resonance in populist, not to say dictatorian, political philosophy. Enemies of the people. The Daily Mail had this as its headline. And it shows you the intensity of the disputes, and it shows you also the willingness to really pull strings of populism. And populism and the British tabloid press are really almost interchangeable. I mean, the Sun, the Mail, these two large circulation newspapers, others besides the Daily Express. You know what I'm talking about if you've read British tabloid newspapers, playing seriously to the lowest gut emotions of the people who read those newspapers.
So I also had a lovely headline. Mine comes from the Sun, and it says, EU dirty rats, Euro mobsters ambush May. Today's that name, right? And there's two men there with guns ready to play the mobster role. And I was going to ask you whether you recognize them, but now you will have to guess with your eyes closed. So I'm going to tell you. It's Macron and Emmanuel Macron, the French president, and Donald Tusk, who is the president of the European Union Council. Right. This is something that, as Gary already said, has actually systematically been conducted by the Leave campaign, not only in the run-up to the elections, but also since. And it is an ample use of crude simplifications and vilifications.
I think, wouldn't you do that with that?
No, I think you do. You do. And what's interesting, it was a fascinating series of panels going on last week, organized by Susan Pennyback from History, Department of History, and several interesting papers that show the way the nostalgia to the empire and nostalgia towards British heroic role in World War II are just being appropriated, at least an attempt to being appropriated by the Leave campaign. And in that context, both David Cameron and Theresa May, who wouldn't want to be called as Europhiles normally, have been compared with Chamberlain. And then the Leavers would say, we want a true Winston Churchill in our darkest hour to, of course, fight on the beaches. Now, what is so interesting and what the Leave campaigners never say, talking about Winston Churchill, who's back in fashion, is the real subtlety of a Winston Churchill. And I'm going to read you some stuff that many of you may not know, except a few took a class with me. But after World War II, the House of Commons debated whether Britain should participate in the European coal and steel community, because there was a real debate. Churchill was on the side of those who said, yes, we should negotiate. Someone stands up and says, are you prepared to part with any degree of national sovereignty, Mr. Churchill? And Churchill says, yes. And here, this is worth reading. The whole movement of the world is towards an interdependence of nations. We feel all around us the belief that it is our best hope. We are prepared to consider, and if convinced, to accept the abrogation of national sovereignty. National sovereignty is not inviolable, and it may be resolutely diminished for the sake of all men in all the lands finding their way home together. Close the quote. That is also the
Just a little bit of, I can't resist it in this context, a little bit of self-promotion. If you'd like to see that quotation in writing, it's the opening paragraph of a book that we published.
In press.
On international organizations. Okay, that's, I don't know, this is a pretty sad story, but it's not exclusively a sad story, because the next two slides, these imaginary slides that you just have to use your imagination to perceive on the screen there, has a photograph from a demonstration, and there are these two young women holding up a sign, and one of them, different signs, one of them says, never gonna give you up, EU up. And another one next to that woman, another woman says, never gonna let you down, EU down. And if you had asked me, I mean, we study European politics, these are, we live and breathe this. If you had asked me, where would you least expect to see a demonstration of hundreds of thousands, no, a million people, actually two demonstrations, pro-EU, where would you least expect that? I would say England. You never get that in England. But actually, that's exactly what did happen. Two massive demonstrations. The aerial photograph is astounding. It just shows Park Lane. If you've been to London, Park Lane is a massive area. Park Lane entirely full, bursting at the seams because all the streets around Park Lane are full of mostly young people demonstrating against Leave.
And also, as some of you will know, two major petitions. The first one, immediately after the vote in 2016, asking for a second referendum, 4 million signatures. And the second one, just a few weeks ago, around the second demonstration, asking for the repeal of what is called Article 50. Article 50 is the procedure that set into motion the negotiations for Britain to extract itself from the European Union. Asking for repeal means staying in the European Union. 6 minutes.
And when you're thinking about a second referendum, bear this fact in mind. It's now been 3 years. In every UK constituency, that's 650 constituencies, there is an aggregate displacement of older people moving out of the population, younger people moving in, of 800 Remain votes every constituency, every year. That disparity between the young and the old, over time, really shapes the aggregate support or opposition to Leave.
It gives you also a window in why, particularly the Leavers, most is turning, but the tide is definitely not in their favor. The tide is not in their favor.
Yeah, you have to say, we'll get onto this in a little bit, but the right now, all the public opinion polls are showing a solid majority for Remain. And it's something, it varies between something like 52-48, but it goes up to well into the 50s, against the 40s, 55-45.
So now we want to talk a bit about where to, and we're going to do this kind of more bit by bit, starting with June 24, the day after the referendum, and how the negotiations went. That will be brief. To some speculation about some long-term effect, potentially, of whatever the outcome might be.
Yes. And we want to start with a kind of a slightly comical statement, both from Cameron the day after the referendum and for Theresa May the day after she was elected head of the Conservative Party and therefore the British Prime Minister. David Cameron said, the British people have made a very clear decision. Nothing could be further from the truth than that statement. Because the character of a referendum is to provide the most minimal amount of information that you can possibly imagine. A single bit, not a byte, a bit, a yes or a no, a dichotomy. And what that means in the context of 45 years of engagement, of the most complex job that could ever be imagined for any government, for the British government, nothing has been more complex than disentangling itself from the European Union. And so politics is the art of compromise. It's the art of figuring out the implications and dealing with the implications of decisions that you make. That's the art of politics. And one of the problems with a referendum is that it cuts off that art of politics and reduces the decision to a simple binary possibility. And then Theresa May, the day after she was elected Prime Minister within the Conservative Party, her famous phrase, Brexit means Brexit. I mean, what does that mean?
Samuel Beckett will tell you. Sounds
like. So, you know, that's really an entrance into the immensely complicated problem of actually realizing the public will in the most kind of brutal, kind of simplistic way that you can imagine the articulation of a preference.
So one of the things, one of the other great pictures you're missing is one of the first meetings after the referendum, and the cabinet is meeting in Czech.
Oh, that one, right? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's do this. It's so much fun. This is a photograph. So May gets elected, and she pushes through Article 50. It gives you 2 years to exit the European Union. And she calls her cabinet to Chequers, which is the country home of the Prime Minister. And this is Brexit, getting out of the EU, is something that members of the Conservative Party have thought and proselytized about for years. And we know that this is going to be happening in the weeks after the referendum. And this is a lovely photograph of Boris Johnson, the Foreign Minister, sitting at the table with a red folder. And what they've done in this photograph is blow up the red folder. This is the red folder for leaving the European Union. And that folder is empty. There's nothing in it.
So there's been a steep learning curve for everyone around. And one of the things that has dawned upon everyone, leavers as well as remainers, is, you know, the UK doesn't get to decide how the world after Brexit is going to look like. So it's been going out and trying to get new trade deals. guys, I think this one with some other minor basis, but Japan, China, and of course our dear good old friend the United States, has been very clear that if there is going to be a trade deal, it's going to be on different terms. Not better terms, worse terms for the UK. So that's one lesson that has become clear. It's very difficult to build an alternative reality that actually really is better than the one the UK is trying to extract from. Another problem was this. What the Leave campaign emphasized strongly is we don't need the European Union because after all we have the Commonwealth. And that fixation with the Commonwealth has also proven to be more in the mind than in the reality. Commonwealth trade is very small compared to trade with the EU. It is 8 to 9% of imports and exports. And again, we had a picture, which you don't see, you don't take my word. While trade with the European Union is around 45%, right? So replacing one with the other is not going to be easy.
And then when one thinks about the economic consequences in the long term, and there are a variety of different estimates of this, virtually every one of them is strongly negative. Now it depends whether the UK is just going to cut off all links. That's the, you know, that's the hard Brexit. And if that were the case, a kind of an estimate which is a summary of the current estimates, over 10 years, on an annual basis, UK per capita income would decline on an annual basis around 3.5%. That's a conservative estimate. If there were some binding of the two in a customs union, we'll explain what the alternatives are in a minute, in a customs union, then you're talking about 1.5% or more on an annual basis. The Bank of England has recently released a report that says that already there's been a 2% decline. The day after Brexit, the UK sterling, the pound, fell to a 31-year low. The recent report on business confidence, and business confidence is around a 10-year low currently in the United Kingdom. So the economic prognosis is very, very negative.
You know, the other interesting things about economic costs is the second most hit economy is the Irish. And that explains an awful lot in terms of the bargaining by Leo Varadkar, the Irish Prime Minister, which is really around trying to minimize as much as possible, to make as soft as possible a Brexit. It's not only about Northern Ireland, we'll get back to this, but also about the overall impact on the Irish economy.
So right now, May is negotiating an extension. The current agreement is April 12th, the guillotine, April 12th.
Yes, I mean, that is this week.
And she can't handle that for reasons we'll go into. Varadkar turns around and says, well, let's give the UK a year or more so. So the Irish actually stand to lose virtually as much as the UK does in terms of trade and per capita GDP.
So on June 23, it seemed as if people were voting and making a binary choice. Leave or stay. That binary choice has disappeared, and now there's a bunch of options at the table, which we summarize into 5. The reality is probably more complex.
There are actually 53, but we summarize them into 5.
It's complex because, as we tried to kind of give you a sense of, what all parties have discovered as they went along is that extricating themselves from a 45 to 50-year-old relationship is very complicated. There's a lot of ties that bind. And what do you do as you untie these long bonds? So this, it's our summary. It's a simplification.
You can see
kind of six big issues six big issues that present themselves and that then structure. One is the immigration. Who gets to decide about immigration? A second is who gets to settle disputes, the role of the European Court of Justice. It's also very much a live issue during the campaign. A third is who gets to negotiate trade deals? To what extent still the EU, to what extent the UK? And then there is the governance of the common market, where there's three very basic big issues. One is, has to do what we call the customs union, which is really having a common tariff, and therefore an external tariff, vis-a-vis the third one, on trading goods. It's for goods only, for manufacturing, a car manufacturing, say, dairy industry, like these types of things. A second is about regulation of trading goods. I mean, this is different from tariffs. It is, for example, how you produce milk, to what standards, which also can affect it. And a third one then is about regulating services. The regulation bit is often is associated with the core of the single market program. That's a single market program that you most of you know that, that was launched in 1986, very much under Margaret Thatcher's influence. So six issues: immigration, European Court of Justice, trade, and then three issues having to do with the common economic governance. The simplest options are the extreme ones. This is a hard Brexit, as Gary mentioned, and the Remain. Remain essentially means back in the EU, no change. Right? The hard Brexit gives the UK sovereignty over all these six issues, but there is a cost. The flip side of that is, as Gary already mentioned, is strong economic costs, both in the long term and in the short term, likely with temporary disruption that can be quite severe. For example, shortages in medicines or certain products that are dear to the British.
So, I mean, let's start with the bookends, because that's very clear. So, Remain is just a continuation of what happened before the referendum. The hard Brexit is, to every one of those issues that Lisbeth raised, it's the UK separate, the UK sovereignty. So these are that's the sovereigntist position. And the irony about the sovereigntist position is, one, it's not only the most expensive economically, it has the worst economic results, but it's kind of the illusion of sovereignty. It's sovereignty where you have the least power over your own fate, where you have least control over the environment, the world in which you live. And then what we're going to talk about are three, neither one of those, well, for Remain, there'd have to be a referendum. There's no majority in the House of Commons for a Remain. So it would have to be a referendum. For the hard Brexit, there are a few stalwart supporters for the hard Brexit, but it's a minority in the House of Commons. So it's those intermediate, trying to kind of square the circle, that most of the future options probably lie.
So you want to start with Theresa May's plan for the withdrawal agreement?
No, that we can let's do that. Essentially, the withdrawal agreement is on immigration. It is special rights for citizens, EU citizens in the UK, grandfathered in. And if you've lived in the UK for 5 years, you get the rights of residence in the United Kingdom. There's an irony about immigration. Immigration was one of the big issues that led to the vote to leave. At that time, in 2016, there were roughly 200,000 immigrants from the EU, and about the same number, slightly more actually, from outside.
Coming every year.
Today, it is it's approaching 50,000 EU immigrants. And the number of external EU immigrants is approaching 250,000. Why is the number of EU migrants, immigrants, workers coming to the UK declining so rapidly? Well, it's because they feel relatively unwelcome. These are often people who are skilled workers, who can actually have alternative options about where they want to work. And a country that says to them, well, we have had a vote on immigration, and particularly EU immigration, because the vote doesn't affect immigration from the outside. So it really, in a sense, the referendum is solving its own issue with respect to immigration. And essentially the main plan, which has been now put forward three times and defeated every time, is a plan for an interregnum. It's a transition period. And it's a transition period for 2 years. It should go up until December 2020. The time is being used up. And in that transition period, there are relatively minor changes from the extant situation. And only in the transition period would the UK position with respect to the EU, the final determination, would that then be negotiated.
So that a few words on the other two options, which are each of them meant to be permanent options. One is to continue on a more narrow path with EU collaboration by sharing a customs union. That is essentially a common external tariff for trade on goods and on goods only. And a big impetus there is that this would hopefully minimize or eliminate a potential border checks around Northern Ireland and Ireland, which is a very big issue for the Irish Republic. So it would minimize border checks, because you could still have work within a common external tariff. But it's limited to goods, so it means the financial sector gets scot-free, and that could be regulated by the UK. It also would mean that the UK would have partial control of negotiating trade agreements, not with respect to goods, but with respect to services. The more intensive option of continued cooperation is one of what is called the Common Market 2 or Norway Plus. And it's Norway Plus because it's the common market, because that's precisely the situation that Norway currently has. Norway has shares with the European Union the single market program, which is all about regulating how you produce and trade goods as well as services. But Norway doesn't have a customs union with the European Union, so that gives it certain freedoms. The implication of having a single market is that you expect mobility and accept mobility of all people. So it would also mean that the UK would not have control over immigration policy with respect to EU citizens. Why is it called a Common Market Plus, and why is it not simply called the Norway solution? The plus is that there would be, in addition to this common market, also a customs union. And why is that? Because a common market would not get rid of border checks. You have the same regulations, but you don't have the same tariffs necessarily. You don't have the same customs codes. So one of the easiest borders on this planet would be Norway or Sweden. Well, your typical truck needs to wait for about 20 minutes because there's forms to be filled. That is for the Irish Republic unacceptable with respect to Northern Ireland, not for economic reasons, but for reasons of sectarian violence, which will just defer to the QA. Right? So in order to avoid that, the UK cannot just get away with Norway's solution. It also has to have a customs union. You tell me then what the difference is between that and being a member of the European Union, but I'll tell you.
Well, I'll sum it up very simply. I think, look, this book would never put me on the spot. Look, essentially, those three intermediate possibilities, each to the current situation of an integrated market between the UK and the EU. Each one of them has one major thing in common. The UK would have no role in decision making. It would have no members in the European Parliament that has a veto. It would have no members in the European Commission, which formulates legislation. It would not participate in the European Council meetings. It would not participate in the Council of Ministers. Students in my class, our classes, know the difference between the European Council and the Council of Ministers. We can go into that later. So the UK is essentially a receiver of rules, but it is not a producer of rules. I mean, that to me is a wonderful definition of, a misguided definition of sovereignty. We take other people's rules, but we don't play a role and we stick our head in the sand and we accept everything that comes from the European Union. So you can see how, you know, difficult this problem is. Unless you're willing just to break ties, cut the Gordian knot, we're out of here. In which case, the economic consequences are going to be severe. If you're trying to get into a halfway stage, while on the one side saying there will not be border stops between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland, and remember those border stops, people fear, will lead to civil war. And there's some good reason for them to believe that. We could go and explain that later. It's there's so many circles and so many squares that every single possibility seems like some kind of hole in which we will never escape.
So I think you might be getting by now why a few days ago there were 8 votes, so-called indicative votes, in the House of Commons, where several of these plans and others were being voted on, and not a single of these plans obtained a majority. The one that came closest is the one that we call the Customs Union, Permanent Customs Union.
That was defeated by 8 votes.
Yeah,
it was 8. And that's the closest that we have come. It seems it's not simply that people are being bloody-minded, but rather the options that they see in front of them in the light of the pressure that was given by the referendum seems so unappetizing.
I think we should probably, shall we open it up now? Do you want to say something about the data?
No, let's open it up. That'd be nice.
Yes.
Let's open it up. Questions are most welcome. You've got to raise your voice.